that's pretty much ascension symptoms, isn't it? Now we'll have a look at freedom of speech. But the thing that I thought of around this was that David Icke, who has always been very strong on his opinion of the world being run by reptilians and what else? That it's infiltrated the royal family, that that there's mind control for the whole planet, the New World Order, all these things. He's been talking about that for how long? 30 years?
Yeah, I
maybe
think so.
40, and people have seen him as an absolute wacko, real crazy. He seems to be getting slowly a better reputation as he goes along because more and more people are actually agreeing with him. And he was planning an Australian tour, about 4 or 5 cities around Australia. And yesterday it was on the news that the government has cancelled his visa and he's not allowed to come. And the reason for that is that the Jewish community complained because they said that he is a denier of the Holocaust, which I don't actually remember him ever talking about. But they said that's what he is, and therefore he's racist, and he'll be inciting hatred towards Jews. Again, I cannot quite see how that works. I've never seen him encourage anybody to hate somebody else. And so the government just cancelled his visa. I think they get a bit, they get the heebie-jeebies once somebody says racist or sexist or hatred, and they go, oh, without actually doing any research, immediately cancelled out his visa. So he can't come now. So I always go, you know, I popped it up on Facebook the other day. Well, you know, where's our freedom of speech? If you can't prove that he's actually telling you to go down the road and beat up a Jew or a Chinese person or a gay person or whatever, then why cancel it? You know, if his ideas are not what they match your own, where is the freedom of speech? It's part of our law, part of constitution. Is that part of your constitution or not?
Yeah.
It is.
Sure.
Yeah. And in Australia, we're meant to be very proud of our freedom of speech, providing you agree with us in the government. So, yeah.
Well, a thing that I've noticed is what was the liberal side. Liberal, you would think, would be you want to have more freedoms.
Right. Isn't that right? What the word means?
Less control. But what I've seen on the liberal left side is, like you were saying, the restriction of freedom of speech. I mean, you can't even say Eskimo anymore.
Why not?
That's derogatory. Derogatory?
Is it?
Yeah.
I thought
it's
it was
supposed
to
be native
like a race of people.
Allusion. I can't remember what it's supposed to be. You know, you couldn't say black or Negro. You know, and the PC things have gotten so ridiculous. You can't, if you accidentally call somebody a trans person the wrong gender, you can get in a whole lot of trouble.
True.
And anti-Semitism has been
always been the touchy one, isn't it? The biggest touchy
one. Mm. Yeah.
Now that in itself, we were talking about the wall the other day and not quite understanding the full meaning of that. They can rave on and on about, you know, trafficking across the border, but there's something more to it. You've got to ask about that whole thing around criticizing Israel as well. Not necessarily Jews, but more Israel, isn't it? Because America's got plenty of Jews in it, and they don't seem to be criticizing them. We're talking about Israelis. So what is that about? There's obviously more to it, right? Why are they super, super sensitive?
To keep control, I think. From what I understand, your average Jew is not part of this, but there's the Zionist faction that run Israel that are very much part of the deep state.
Yeah.
And they want to make sure nobody says anything bad about them. You can't, you don't even dare. One guy got, gosh, somebody in New York, maybe a politician. Oh God, this was a while ago and I can't remember the details, but at some point he said something about the Rothschild family who own all the banks. And he got in a whole lot of trouble for being anti-Semitic.
Oh.
Because the Rothschilds are Jewish.
Are they? Okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
And
some of the things that just don't even seem to connect together to the rest of us who listen. I mean, you say Rothschild, that's talking about a family. It's not talking about anything else about those people. So
And you have to be so careful. The political correctness is just ridiculous these days.
So don't you being think? Offended is another great topic for us to talk about, isn't it? Do we move on to that from freedom of speech? I mean, it's...
Sure.
Yeah. When we do all our personal development stuff, the first thing you've got to learn is that the reaction of being offended is your own. You can choose to be offended or not. And sometimes when you throw something out there and you think it's perfectly fine, and then somebody will be offended and you don't know why. So here's an example. I mean, we're not talking about racist and sexist and obvious comments that could, you know, really bother people. At one point when I just had my first child and I was in a group of women in a circle, like in a, you know, a networking party, and we got on to talking about children and they were talking about contraception or something. And I said, well, gosh, you know, I went off contraception and I got pregnant in the first month. And everyone's like, wow, girl, look at that. Ooh, you know, so we just carried on talking. And one woman I didn't notice was not talking. So fine, okay. Then after that, apparently she just hated me to death. She tried to sabotage my business. She did all sorts of crazy things. She was offended because she'd been trying for years to have a child. So, you know, it's your choice to be offended. But honestly, that how was I to know? And why should I not say the truth that was about me and not about her? Where's the fine line here? It's not about trying to say the right thing so we don't offend anybody, because then you'll say nothing at all. Nothing.
Exactly.
So it does connect in with freedom of speech, doesn't it? Really.
It does. I think the older the soul you are, the more you've done your development, your work, the less likely you are to be offended.
Mm.
An example, swearing.
Right.
Swear words, right? So some people can be just totally offended if you say those swear words. And I never felt that way. And one of the reasons was that I've always, you know, what's so evil about a certain word? You know, what's so bad about it? How can one, you know, poo-poo can be okay, but shit is bad?
Mm.
Logically, it doesn't make sense. And then I had an experience where my mother had a stroke, left brain, and she couldn't talk. And she was trying to feed herself and making a mess. And I just said, give me this spoon, you know. And she went, shit. And then she went, whoo, meaning, hey, I said a word. And it occurred to me then that why could she swear but not say anything else? Maybe because swear words connect left and right brain, and her right brain was still working. I don't know. So I had this sort of theory that maybe they're actually words of power. And that's why they're so suppressed. Whenever society and culture says, this is bad, I always suspect that there's probably something good about it. but with my children, I did not raise them that they couldn't swear. What I said was, you have to know when you can't.
Right.
When you're at school and when you're at other people's houses,
yeah,
you don't, you can't.
Yeah.
And as long as you can keep that straight, you can swear when you're around me. Some people got really freaked out about that because they'd be at my house, whatever, and my kid would swear, and their kid would go home and say, you know, mommy, he said the bad words, right? And it's just... And get offended. It's like, oh my God, have you got nothing better to do with your time and energy than be offended that my child said shit? I mean, I think if somebody gets offended by something, they have to identify with it somehow. Yes. And that's because if I were to say to you, you're a purple elephant, you would say,
can't relate to that.
Yeah, can't relate to that. But if I say that,
you're a dumb blonde. How about that?
Okay, how about you're a dumb blonde? You're an oversexed dumb blonde.
Oversexed dumb blonde. Second chakra out of control. Yeah, and then I might go, If I was in profession, I'd go, like, mask is up, right? But inside, I might going, because there's some element of truth in there that I might think of myself. Now, whether it's true or not is not the key, right? There's that. So that's why I think that's a really good example, that the dumb blonde thing that I found for such a long, long time, I was constantly using big words and being super efficient and trying to prove prove to the world that I am far from dumb. And I am intelligent, right? So it's not like I had to, you know, I was not pretending to be something I was not. I am intelligent, but I still had to kind of prove myself, particularly when I was working in the computer industry where at least 80% of the people working there were men. And so you'd still get the, you know, token blonde thing. And in the 80s, it was quite okay to put sexist jokes in. I don't remember many dumb blonde jokes said around me, but you kind of knew that they were still in the society. And so I really had to prove myself, you know. And it's only since I started doing the self-development work that I started realizing, oh, I don't actually need to prove that. I know that I'm intelligent.
Exactly.
And anybody who assumes that I'm dumb just doesn't know me. They don't know
it's
me.
It's just yet. Dumb. So that taking offense to me is often because it's triggering some suppressed shame.
Mm-hmm.
And your example of, you know, there was that little part of you that just identified with being a dumb blonde and felt like you needed to prove otherwise. And another one that I think of is black pride.
Right.
Whereas what they're really saying, no, you know, you're dissing me. I have more pride than that. And to me, it was like, no, that's not pride. That's shame.
Do you think gay pride is part of that as well?
Probably. I think pride is misused.
That word, there's something about it, isn't there? Yeah. And who started organizing it and who put that word into their groupings and said you should put this on a placard or put it out the front of your group? There's something something not right about that, isn't there?
Yeah. Mm. I think true pride doesn't have to talk about it, announce it,
just
put
like,
it out there.
Like the intelligence, right? Once you know it, you don't actually have to tell anybody. Because you know it and you just, I don't know if you just emit it or if you just don't need to prove yourself anymore.
Good thoughts.
Mm.
So I would like to ask people, what offends you? How do you feel about political correctness? I know another correct thing is spiritual correctness. Mm. And that one is another thing that bothers me, which is why I created the Spiritually Incorrect Room, as you know.
I love that room. Yeah.
Because we're also, the law of attraction has got people being terrified to think or say anything negative.
Mm.
And it just doesn't work that way. Your conscious mind is not the control. It's what's going on unconsciously. So in the Spiritually Incorrect Room, the idea is that you seal it off so it doesn't affect anything. There's no possible negative repercussions for anything that goes on in this room. And it's not a physical 3D room. It's an energetic space you use in your imagination. And then if there's somebody who you're having challenges with or groups or whatever, you bring them in the room with you. And then in your imagination. And then without any spiritual correctness, you just like let your inner child come out. So if a child's parent, say mom, treated them badly as a kid, you don't go in there and go, you know, mom, I understand that with your childhood that you're damaged.
Excuses.
But, you know, this is really hard for me. You're like, you'll never talk to me like that again. Do you understand? And
you can
get a big bear behind you or a dragon or a big lion to back you up that you can take a bludgeon and hit them in your mind if you want. Nothing goes out. You're not actually hurting anything. And what I'll find is people will go in there feeling just overwhelmed, the shame, their anger, the resentment, whatever, and they'll let it out this way, and then they'll start giggling.
Mm.
And at the end of it, the room is like the holodeck on Star Trek. So we ask the computer to uncreate, you know, dissolve, get rid of that program of the other person as the oppressor. So that it, you're not actually bringing that person's soul in here. You're bringing your personality impression of them, the part that you've had a problem with. So you delete it and just take it out of your reality. And people will just start giggling and they'll go, ha, 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 that was fun.
Yeah. I know I had a lot of problem when you first explained that to me, to give myself permission to say these dreadful things about people when I'd been taught to be a good little girl from the whole beginning part. Right. Took a long time. But then when I got a little bit more used to it and would let loose and I'd be crying, throw myself about. And then what's amazing is that once I'd let it all out and said what I needed to say, the reaction of that other person or my impression of that other person would often be completely unexpected.
Yeah.
What they choose to bring back. So where that comes from is interesting too. I don't know whether it really is they actually can hear you and they are giving you a response, or whether it's me suddenly finding, is it compassion perhaps, or I don't know. But it's just, it's so often the response is totally different. Yeah.
You know, if you're going around with a bunch of suppressed anger, fear, shame, resentment, whatever, and you release it, feeling is healing, it's like you take off that lens through which you've seen them, and you're able to see more truth to who they are.
It's a brilliant exercise.
It's a wonderful place if you want to take your inner child in there. Because a lot of, you know, people had things that happened to them when they're very young, and children are so powerless. And as an adult, if you go in and you just imagine yourself at 5 or 6 or whatever, if there had been some traumatic thing that happened at that age, you go in there with this child and you go, you know, I'm an adult now. You don't touch her, you know, and the inner child gets to feel protected and safe. And it really shifts a lot inside. You know, I love doing aspect work where you're working with your inner child or your inner feminine, your inner masculine, and all the other inner parts, you know, that we have there.
And if anybody if you need help with this kind of thing, if you're a bit scared to do it by yourself, ring Sarah. Get Sarah to do it. Book a session with her because she's very, very good at it. And on that note, I think we've probably done enough.
All right. So please subscribe, like, all those good things. Hit the little bell, notifications. Any comments you put in, we'd love to hear from you. And
we do answer.
Until next time.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.